Tirthankar Patnaik, strategist at Mizuho Bank, joins us right now on the show with his thoughts. So much to talk about. Tirthankar, I would have wanted to start off with the no confidence motion, because that's been playing its part on the market's mind, but can't not talk about the currency to start off with. 69.11 at all-time lows today. Must say though, it's been a gradual fall rather than a slam dunk one. What do you make of this? Is there more in store for the rupee to weaken? Because that's by and large the belief.
So if you look at if you look at the real effective exchange rate, we are still at around 106 or 107 or thereabouts. So purely from that perspective, one could expect some kind of depreciation on the currency going forward as well. But if you look at just pure market factors, given the pressure, given the uncertainty that we are seeing in the global markets, given the the uncertain environment in general globally, plus rising crude prices, which do have an impact on India, so the pressure on the currency is fairly strong, and so one could expect the INR to go down further before it starts stabilizing.
Tirthankar, do you think that the trend which will continue in the second half of the calendar year as well? We've seen the crude prices depreciating, we've seen the rupee depreciating, and all these factors may not augur well for the macros of India. How should one play the theme now going ahead? We've seen the IT stocks already doing well.
So, if you just compare this year versus last year, clearly macros are on a much dimmer, they have much dimmer prospects. You are looking at a 30% premium to, crude imports, which are, vitally important for India. That itself hurts our current account deficit in a meaningful way, our trade deficit and the current account deficit. People usually compare how, our current account deficit or the external situation is versus the last time we were in such a situation, which was around in mid 2013. Clearly, India has come a long way from there, and the kind of volatility we saw on the rupee in mid 2013 is not something we are seeing now. But the direction remains fairly due south, given we have a higher trade deficit, we have a higher current account deficit, we are looking at much higher cost of funds because the rate cycle has finally turned around. You have inflation not just from the fuel aspects, but also from core, which has gone to 6% plus level. So there is some amount of strength building up in the economy, and parts of which are overheating, and therefore macros will start factoring that number, that kind of environment. And to answer your question, do we see these things panning out in the second half? Clearly the uncertain environment is likely to remain, starting with the Sino-US trade wars, where we've not seen any kind of capitulation at this point. We are significantly looking at numbers now becoming bad enough to be affecting global growth prospects. We had the IMF World Economic Outlook update coming up. They stopped short of downgrading GDP numbers, but that could start happening as well. So until we see some kind of resolution there, you will see the pressure building up on the external front. On the domestic front, if the RBI pauses after a rate hike, the August rate hike is almost a given. But if post that there is some kind of comforting commentary from the RBI, you might go back to the recovery story, and we will be looking back at how asset quality has affected banks, and are we looking at credit growth coming back up. So the recovery clearly seems to have slowed down in the interim, and at least the beginning of second half looks pretty dicey at this point, and valuations are not in support at 21 times forward earnings.
Those concerns, Tirthankar, they remain. The credit growth that we've not seen for the longest time, and also, investment by the private sector, that's still lacking. But, these concerns remain. You've got rupee depreciating, you've got crude prices inching higher. But there's another factor, actually, which could be impacting the Indian markets, and that's politics. We've got very important elections, state elections lined up. Then we've got general elections for next year. And today, vote of confidence. Well, not to worry there, I'm sure BJP will win that considering they have the majority in Lok Sabha. But how do you think these political factor can impact the markets going ahead now?
you know, since mid-14, one particular factor that we were not looking at for India was political uncertainty. In fact, this was something that was, you know, when you compare India, when you compared India with the rest of the emerging market peers, you typically looked at a much more stable political environment, something we had not seen in the last many, many years. And in terms of decisiveness from the government, you know, right or wrong, things have been pretty playing out on those lines. Now the no confidence motion, which will be something, it's something that's happening after 15 years. The opposition had asked for it in, right around the budget session, but the government has gone for it now. The numbers, as you rightly pointed out, the arithmetic clearly helps the ruling party. NDA has more than 315 odd seats. What would be interesting are a couple of things. We saw some kind of opposition unity right after the Karnataka elections. So one has to see if those, if that unity actually pans out in terms of numbers. The issues that are likely to be raised in the no confidence motion are of not much consequence for the market, you know, despite however much they may be important for India as a country. So from a market perspective, from an economic perspective, what would be purely interesting is if you are seeing opposition unity, which could hurt into BJP's prospects into the, in 2019. There are many states where there was a very good performance by the BJP in 2014. UP is one case in point. So opposition unity will clearly show if we are likely to look at those numbers again and with a bit more concern. What will be also interesting to see is what happens with the parties which are not part of the UP also. So you have parties which have abstained, they've stopped short of joining either the UPA or the NDA. You have the BJD, you have the TRS, you have the ADMK. So these are parties whose behavior would also be, interesting to watch. While the numbers will be supportive for the NDA, I mean, we'd be keen to watch whether these companies, these parties are likely to align with the NDA in terms of stability for the 2019 elections.
Tirthankar, so at the end of today, and assuming that it turns out as the market is expecting it to be, or as people are expecting this no confidence motion to turn out to be, what's the takeaway for the market here? Would the numbers have any kind of material impact on Monday morning's trade? Because we have the Prime Minister speaking last, but does the outcome of the numbers, if it's sub 300 or above 300, or in case of parties abstaining, sub the halfway mark or sub the two-thirds mark versus above the two-thirds mark, have any material impact on market sentiment on Monday, or Monday onwards rather?
Like I said, the only sense is, for the market, it's a given that the no confidence motion should not have much impact on the government's functioning. What would be interesting is opposition unity. So if you are seeing, parties coming around and voting together in support of the no confidence motion, that will be something interesting for pre-2019 calculations. So we are looking at a repeat performance by the NDA, that's the base case for 2019 elections. But the arithmetic in certain states would have to be reworked. And that in turn would have an impact, bearing on what kind of numbers are we working for, are we looking at as a base case for the 2019 elections. The third part is, parties which are fence sitters for now, let's see which way they work out. So, in terms of numbers, things are fine, but in terms of opposition unity is what one would be keen to watch in the no confidence motion today.
Okay. What drives the markets from now until whatever is possible to predict, Tirthankar? Let's say the next 12 months until the May 19 elections, what drives the markets higher? Is it the currency sensitives which have the natural tailwind, so the exporters benefit out of it, and the consumer names continuing what they are doing? Or do you believe that it could be other spaces that could come to the fore to hold the markets up?
So let me take a step back and let's see what our strategy is. So our strategy is for an India recovery story. We believe that the India recovery story is likely to play out for a while now, for the next 2 years, 3 years even. And at this point, consumption is fairly strong as a theme. And anything that supports consumption, anything that supports the financing of consumption is something that's likely to drive the market. And, you know, we would be partial towards those sectors. So, you know, you have autos, you have FMCG, despite all the valuation, you have private financials, you have NBFC. So those are all playing the theme for consumption in India. You also are likely to expect some kind of a turnaround in investment, although we don't expect that to happen anytime soon. But investment as a theme is likely to support India maybe, you know, after a couple of quarters now. The global cyclicals or, you know, INR-based sectors, they are in vogue right now, given the performance of the INR. So for the next one or two quarters, when we expect pressure on the INR to continue, one would expect, you know, information technology, pharma, to some extent even, you know, metals to be the parts of the portfolio which are likely to do better. But our base case remains one of a consumption-based recovery, which will slowly, you know, turn into higher investment and which will slowly turn into higher capacity utilization. You know, we've had many you know, false starts over the last 4 years. Many times you've had good numbers for investments for a couple of quarters, couple of months, only to be, you know, slowing down again and again. We are seeing something very similar happening now. Last two quarters we saw investment start picking up, but now again you are looking at, you know, June data for, you know, new project starts is meaningfully muted if you go by CMI figures. So one has to wait for the investment theme to pick up, and we don't see that happening anytime soon. Until then, we will be, you know, having a consumption-focused portfolio. Expensive, but something to, you know, hold on to.
Okay, well, consumption remains the overarching theme of this year because of higher MSP, and also most of the analysts in the street have been betting on the recovery in the rural market. And I was coming to that, Tritankar, the safety premium that one has been paying so far this year for all these companies, which are also, you know, quoting at higher valuations. Do you think that's still a safer bet, or it's time now, considering the correction that one has seen in the broader markets, to start identifying good stocks even in the broader market?
See, that identification of good stocks remains a theme at all points in time. Part of the carnage we've seen, especially in the mid-cap space, does offer significant opportunities. I would say, you know, good stocks will, the identification of good stocks is a continuing theory. But in terms of a portfolio twist, one would remain, you know, overweight towards consumption themes, despite the valuation premium that we are paying. Yes, valuations are stretched, especially in the FMCG space, consumption in general, valuations are very stretched at this point. But the alternative is not something that I would bet on right now. Yes, for, you know, one or two quarters, you will have INR-based themes coming up, but India's primary objective for the next couple of years is a consumption-based recovery. That's our strong point, and which would eventually lead to higher and higher capacity utilization. Not, you know, in many parts of the world, this is a story that's playing out. We have many places where, you know, bank asset quality is as bad as ours. We have many places where inflation is not really picking up. At least in India, you know, we have an example where there is overheatedness in the consumption space, something that the central bank is now taking cognizance of. So this is a multi-year growth story, and many of the steps taken by the government, not really in the financial space, but, you know, in terms of governance, are likely to have much longer positive impact for us in the next couple of years. So we remain fairly, you know, sanguine on the India recovery story over a long-term period, but not something that's likely to play out in the near term.
Interesting. Tritankar, my final question really, and that is on autos. They seem to have gone off the boil slightly. Now, I remember 9 months ago, everybody was talking about how the valuation gap between a normal consumption, consumer, FMCG, staple name, arguably because it's more easy to predict their growth versus autos per se, but the valuation differential is fairly high and they form a part of this consumer pack. While the monthly numbers or the monthly run rate still seems to be strong, the stocks aren't quite there. What do you do here? There is chalk and cheese performance within the auto pack as well.
So, it's essentially segment based. So you are looking at fairly good numbers. You're looking at fairly good performance in the PV space until now. CVs did fairly well in FY18, but going forward, you're looking at a gradual slowdown in the economy because of higher crude prices. You are looking at stocks which have performed fairly well in the CV space. So there is likely to be some kind of a correction on that front, and we should be cognizant of that. From a theme based perspective, PVs are likely to continue to outperform in the next two to three quarters. But like I said, you take a step back and you look at the macros. It is 2018 is not 2017. So the consumption story remains, but the drivers that were fueling the 2017 kind of story in terms of comfortable crude, comfortable cost of funds, those drivers are not really that powerful at this point. So one would see this kind of divergence coming up in the auto space as well.
Okay, Tirthankar, we'll leave it at that. Many thanks for joining us today and giving us that perspective. Really appreciate your time.